and profit. So if you want to make profit, well, I'm going to tell you something about it. Before I continue in English, is there somebody in the audience who doesn't understand Dutch? One, two, three, a little. Okay, two and a half. That means I'll continue in English, no problem. Well, for me, no problem, but if you, it's always the question if you understand what I'm saying. Anyway, I've done two talks prior to this. Those were more theoretical stuff. This is practical stuff, including a demo. That's why I used the big beamer, so you can, in a few moments, actually see a demonstration. First, who am I? Well, my name is Jerome Batten. I'm into IT, and I call myself an innovator. And my job role is a solutionist, so I provide solutions for IT problems. And that's all the spam regarding me. In pictures, I'm also active in the Boy Scout movement. I have a wheelchair adapted van with a nice tux on the side, courtesy of my wife who gave it to me for my birthday. And I've been a volunteer firefighter for 10 years. And even rescued a dog once who was swimming. And long story, he was in danger. And on the right bottom side, you see my helmet, and some part of it were even melted. So it was hot. Well, not for me, but for my material. Anyway, what is a mainframe? Does anybody know what a mainframe is? It's a piece of hardware. It's old, and it's hardware is built to facilitate massive parallel work. So it's for most of the times it's used for administrative work. So it's very much database and record oriented. And as you can see in the picture, you have in the top left side, you have the processor, and that's just a small part of the mainframe. Everything else is hardware. So if you have a connection to a hard disk, it goes through storage control and from storage control to control units, and it's all so a lot of it is done in hardware, which makes to in the end it tries to minimize the time that the processor needs to get things done, because the rest of the hardware has already done stuff. So a networking stack is hardware, hard disk interfacing is hardware. Everything that a normal PC does on the processor, you just, in the mainframe, you put into hardware. So it's massive parallel hardware parallelization. Now, and it's old. Mainframes originated as early as computing did, so 1940s, 1950s. And of course they were slow, and they tried to make this as efficient as possible. And it was job oriented. So you had a job, you submitted a job to the mainframe, and you got output from the job. That's basically what it does. And at that time, those things were programmed with these kinds of cards. This is an actual programming card. And you punch holes in them, and you have a stack of those cards, thousands of them with the program, thousands of them with the data. You just put them into a reader, he reads it, it goes into the mainframe, he handles the program and the data, and he punches a new set of output cards that you can then use. Thankfully, we don't have to do card punching at the moment. We've got the terminal in a few seconds, so you can see that even works. Now, mainframe at the moment, they still exist. And they are still in use. A lot of times within the banking sector, the core software of a bank, even at this time, day and age, is still run on a mainframe. There has been decades and decades of investment in software in that, so there's still a lot of maintenance to be done. And so they still exist. And the fun thing is that the sysadmins of mainframes are more or less getting older and older and older and older. So there is a room there. If you're interested in mainframes, it's very easy to get a job in that direction. and you'll have a job for the rest of your life. One of the things with a mainframe is that the processor instruction set hasn't changed since the 50s. So it's possible to make an emulator for a mainframe processor. And there's actually a project for that. It's called Hercules. So Hercules is an open source mainframe emulator. It's just like KVM and KEMU, but instead of emulating PC hardware, it emulates the instruction set of a mainframe. And in practice, that means that for every one instruction that the mainframe should do, you need about 100 instructions on the processor to get things done. But these days, the processor's very smart, so you don't really have a lot of problem with that delay. Hercules. It's an IBM a mainframe emulator for System 370, which is a hardware piece, the ESA 390 and the 64-bit, because System 370 and ESA are 31-bit platforms. I know it's a very strange number, but that was the mainframe architecture at that time. And Hercules runs on Linux, Windows, Solaris, FreeBSD, and macOS. So if you want to do something with mainframe, and play around with the mainframe, it's very easy, and you should use the Hercules project. But there are some pitfalls that I will discuss to make it easier for you. It is easy, but at least it will be a lot easier after this talk. So how does it look? Well, on the left side, you have an actual front panel of an IBM. On the right side, you see Hercules on the Windows with, well, same kind of buttons and dials and so on. So the emulation of the mainframe itself is also graphically similar. And what does it do? Well, it runs software. It's as simple as that. There are many, to run a software on Hercules, of course you need an operating system. And a lot of mainframe operating systems are publicly in public domain. They are available because up till the end of the 60s, a lot of mainframe software by IBM was developed with federal grants, which meant that they should publicize the source code. So after 1970 something, it became closed, but everything before that is open source. Now, if you have a license and the hardware, you can even run licensed code, OS 390, ZOS, whatever. But otherwise, there is the public domain versions of the operating systems that you can use. And there are several of them that you can use to run an operating system on Hercules. And we will discuss one of the most popular of them. It's the MVS. And, well, you could even run Linux if you like. The mainframe version of Linux, but that's pretty boring. So you can do that for yourself. What not to do if you're interested in running a mainframe. First, don't Google the Hercules project, because it will point you to hercules390.org. Don't do that. Last updated date, as you can see, 2010. The guy maintaining that, being owner of the domain, he's missing in action. He doesn't respond to email. He's gone. So there's a big community, but you can't find it through this website. If you follow to his website, you'll find his name and stuff, and his software is still downloadable, but, well, the guy himself is missing. Also, at some point in time, somebody, Mr. Volker, made an MVS, that's the operating system, 3.8J, that's the version, of course, a turnkey system. So it was very easy to use MVS on Hercules. Brilliant stuff, but also outdated. But if you go to this website, you think, well, that's cool, let's download that. Well, don't, because you'll run older software, and there's newer and more user-friendly software available. So, lights on, but nobody home. What should you do? Well, it's the main site. Go to hercules390.eu. Use that site. That's being updated as we speak all the time. This is, these are the links that you should use if you're interested in Hercules. There is a mailing list on Yahoo Groups. It's very active. I've followed it now for 2 months and I've got 500 emails in my mailbox. So it's active. You can ask questions. It's a friendly bunch most of the time. And the easy start, I told you about MVS 3.9J Turnkey 3 system, but there is also a 4-. And why 4-? Well, it's like 0.98 release. So they thought, let's keep some room for improvement. So there's not a release 4, but it's 4-. But it's much more user-friendly than version 3. It's maintained. And there is even a link where you can download the stuff and download the zip file, unpack it, and you're in business in no time, which I will show you in a few minutes. And start learning, because mainframe technology is completely different from anything you've seen so far. It doesn't resemble Windows. It doesn't resemble Linux. It's completely different stuff. And on YouTube, there is this guy called Moshix. I even exchanged some emails with him regarding this presentation, etc. He has over 30 instructional videos on how to do things on MVS emulator, MVS OS on Hercules emulator, explaining everything, installing software, how it runs, how things work in a mainframe. Excellently done. So, what do you need to get this running? Well, simple, use a PC with Linux. Well, or Windows, if you really must. You know how my feelings are on the subject, but it's possible. You can even run it on a Raspberry Pi. And I know Raspberry Pi is very small hardware, but even when you have one mainframe instruction translated to 100 CPU instructions on a Raspberry, it's still 100 or 1,000 times faster than the original mainframe in the 60s. So you're safe. Now, to connect to a mainframe, you need a terminal session, a terminal emulator, something that looks tries to simulate being a screen and a keyboard. Hey, if you have the hardware, you can use cards, but I guess that you're not interested in using cards to program or use a mainframe. Just use an emulator. Now, the terminals at that time were IBM products like any other, and they have numbers. So 3270 is the name for a terminal to connect to a mainframe, an IBM mainframe. So if you install, if you do on your own Linux version, apt search 3270, or Yermin search 3270, you will find it. It's available in the repository. It says there's nothing weird or difficult about it. Just install it and it works. Then install, of course, the Hercules software. That's the zip file I showed you earlier. And of course, some operating system distribution. And in my case, we're using MVS. Okay, is this picture clear to anybody? Anybody questions? It's very simple. Okay. In the end, well, you get this. If you like, you get a manual and a very small Raspberry Pi simulating to be a mainframe. Now, the world of mainframes uses its own lingo, its language, you know, terms, abbreviations, and a few you should know to understand. And these are the basic terms you should know, and I'll explain them when you start working with a mainframe. One is the DASD, directly attached storage device. That's the IBM term for a hard disk. So if they talk about a DASD volume, DASD interfaces, DASD devices, whatever, it's sort of a hard disk. And a mainframe is a very, very simple system where every functionality is provided by a subsystem. So if you don't install it, it doesn't work. It's not like a Linux kernel with a free BSD tools around it. No, you've a mainframe, you only have the kernel and everything else you have to add to it, even with an operating system. So TSO is the term used for time sharing option. Without TSO, it's a single user system. With TSO, it's a multi-user system. And it's all in that MVS that will that I'll show you later. It's all in there. But it's for you, if you read stuff, if you follow the YouTube movies, it's you need to know the terms. It makes life a lot easier. JES2 is the job entry system. It's the subsystem that provides the job queuing mechanism. So when you want something done, you submit a job, the job gets into a job queue. At some point in time, the mainframe says, okay, time, so you're next. It handles your job, and then it saves the data or whatever, and the job is finished. So that's JES2. Kix is a front end to transactional software. So you have transactional application, and you want some nice data entry screen, and the editor and the software to show you data entry screens is Kix. The other thing very important is data sets, because there is no file system, but you need to store things on a hard disk. So if you look back at the 50s, how can I give somebody some space to do his work in and prevent him from filling the hard disk? They use data sets. So the sysadmin makes a data set for you, and he asks you, or whatever, he defines the number of space that gets allocated to you, and that's your space. That's fixed, like a fixed database. But then it's a data set. In a data set, you can even have other data sets. So like a subdirectory and a subdirectory, but then a data set is sort of a file specifically for you. And within that file, you can have sub-files, sub-data sets. I know it gets murky, but try to think of it as very simple systems, and you'll be fine. And the other thing to know, last thing, a catalog is a system list of available stuff. So if you add software to a mainframe, that's fine, but if it's not mentioned in the catalog, the system won't know about it. So there's no path variable, it's completely different. Okay. Next, in a few moments, we're going to start the Hercules emulator, and we make a terminal connection. And the terminal connection looks like this. So this is basically what the terminal would look like with a logo and whatever. On the bottom left side, you see log on, and you enter a username, and after that a password. I'll show you in a minute. And then we'll start working with that. And after I've logged in, this is my session. Oh well, this is a screenshot of a session. This is not my session, as you will see. It's a menu system. Okay? Any questions so far, or shall I go and proceed with the demo? No questions? Everybody still awake, sort of? Okay. Demo time. This is where I need to mirror my screen. Schermen, spiegelen, toepassen. Zo. Now you should see, I hope, the same as I do. Otherwise, yeah, would be a little bad. Okay. So you see my terminal session. Okay. Now in this tab, I will just simply start with a script, the mainframe, and now my mainframe is booting. It'll take some time, even with a mainframe, and at the same time I have a terminal session already running. That's this one. That's still empty, and in a few minutes, seconds, whatever, I will make a connection. Yep, there you got it. So now I have a terminal session. Um, Yep. And on the left side, you still see something happening on the mainframe, and there is my logo on screen. Yeah? Now, this time I even prepared. The funny thing about a terminal session is that you don't need a mouse. So I don't have to point somewhere. So I'll just get it out of the way. Everything. Let's see, I can use this Herc2 with a password, see you later. Now there are no, I'm greeted with a welcome message, and that's basically it. I press enter again. There's a message of the, I know, well, it's not important. It's quite invisible, yeah, I thought about it. This is a fortune cookie. And this is the menu, and I hope that you see now blue, and let's see what you see. Yeah, that's about it. Yeah. Yeah. Looks better, huh? Right? So, like I said, this is the mainframe with MVS 3.8. Yay, Jay. And that's the... It's funny to do this with a terminal session. Now, with the menu, it's very simple. You enter an option, you press enter, and you get that option. So for instance, I could select one RFE, enter. Now if I want to go back, I press the function key 3, and I'm back. So it's function key 3, always gets you back. And the other two to know is the function key 7 and function key 8, page up, page down. That's it. But if you don't know that, it becomes difficult. But if you know it, it's easy. So I pick option number 3. And let's see, I want to go to... Where do I want to go to? I don't know. Option 3. Oh yeah, so here you've got this. Well, I'm going to explain that you've got libraries, and libraries like a directory. You've got a data set to manage. Yeah? I talked about data sets, but option 4 is a DS list, and a DS is a partitioned data set, and a partitioned data set, PDS, is the term for a data set with data sets in it. So that's a PDS. If I take option 4, and it says, well, it's nice, but do you have a data set? Well, yeah, I do. It's a 6 system.lib. The S for select, enter. That's the information. I should have done the E of enter, E. So, and now in a system library, the sys2j shell lib, I have a lot of programs and files to look at. And I can use F7, F8 to browse through them. Now, just suppose I want to do some prime number calculation. You can see, let me go down. Here you have prime GCC. I hope that you can see that. So because also the GCC C compiler is already installed for you, as a lot of COBOL compilers, Fortran compilers, it's all available already. Well, the funny thing is, let's have a look. I don't know if there's anybody here who understands COBOL, but this is the 7F8, I can scroll through, and believe it or not, this is actually a very easy editor, because I can change things on the fly. I can make this Hercules job C, and then I go up here, enter, and it's saved. So that's simple, right? What you should know is the an identifier of the job. So if I would change this file a lot, I would use C, D, E, F, G, whatever, just for my own user-friendly information. The other thing to know is the class of the job that I will submit, and class A means immediately execute. So as soon as I submit this job to the system, it will start compiling and it will start running the program instead of another job class where it just gets in the queue and maybe put on hold, or it waits until in the evening to do the job. This one will do execute immediately. And the other thing to know is the message class is H, and message class H means hold all messages. I'm not interested in the messages, just put them in the output of the job and not on my screen. What does this thing do? It calculates prime numbers, and down at the bottom there is this parameter saying I want 200,000, not 200,000 prime numbers, but it will try every prime number until the number 200,000. That seems like a lot, so let's just see how much time it will need to run this job. And I press sub or submit, and that will submit the job to the mainframe. It will execute, compile the program and execute the program. So it's now executing program, and it sends me a small message that's hard to read, I guess. If you say it red lines, yeah, it's very, oh, but that's bad. That's bad. Okay, simply try this at home, but I can tell you what it says. It says, oh, better? Okay, so you can see it's job Hercules 02C, job 00005. So this number 5 I need to remember, because I'm going to look at the output in a few seconds, and then I need to look for the output of job number 5. Right? Enter. Well, I'm not longer interested in this program. I go back with F3, and option 8, it says output list. And there you have number Hercules 02C, job identifier 005, right? Now, let's have a look at that one. Select, enter. This is the output of the job. So it starts with this is a JES2 job log, you know, JES as in the job entry system. There are some things going on here. And on the right side, you see the RC. RC is a return code, like the exit level in Linux. So a return code of 0, no problem, everything worked fine. Now you may think that I know a lot about mainframe. You're mistaken. This, as long as it works, I can explain it. If it doesn't work, we're all in a pickle. Okay, so it shows me now the program code, just as I as it was in the program. It mentioned something allocated to system punch. Here it says elapsed time, so it took it 0.2 of tenth of a second, so to calculate all these prime numbers. So that's pretty fast. If you think we're emulating a mainframe on a simple laptop, then the processing power is not that bad, as long as you're single user, you know, 10,000 users as on a mainframe, then it becomes a little difficult. Job steps, program, and here are the prime numbers to be continued. Okay. And I can go back if I like. There are utilities there and stuff. Now, if I'm finished with it, I simply press F3 again. I'm out of my menu system, and I'm going to shut down my mainframe like this. Now, on the left, you see the shutdown is started, and now I need to log off from my terminal session, and I'm logged off. And I even have to close the connection, because otherwise the mainframe won't. So now the mainframe is shutting down, and at some point in time you will stop. And if you look at the files, CD Tito's 2017 TK4 find punt so there are PDFs where you can read. There's a manual included how things work. Like I showed you earlier, use the MVS command to start up your mainframe. It starts Hercules. Hercules is included in the zip file, so you don't have to install Hercules as a package. That way they know that they have the latest Hercules version. So here's Hercules for Linux, Hercules for ARM, Hercules for 64-bit, Hercules for Windows, it's all in there. Hercules for Mac, Darwin. Some scripts, there are some printers defined, and then there's the configuration. And in the configuration file of Hercules, you can define your complete hardware. So how many printers do you have? How many terminals do you want to be able to connect? How many hard disks are in the system? It's all entered into the configuration file of Hercules, so it can simulate the hardware. And just go to YouTube, follow Moshik's examples, and you'll be fine. And here you have the DASD subdirectory with all the simulated hard disk files. And every device has an ID, and that's the number at the end of the but it's only interesting if you are really into that. Okay, so what I can show you about running a mainframe on Linux. Are there any questions? Oh, a lot of questions. Yes. Yeah. Yes, there are still a lot of applications available in the public domain that you can install in MVS. A lot of, in the turnkey system, a lot of software, programming software is available. So the GCC compiler, COBOL compilers, Fortran, ALGOL, PL1, all those compilers are available. So if you want to learn to jobs are still available, are still there in the market. And there's actually an organization in Amersfoort who rents out people specialized in that, and they're growing enormously. You can use this with a COBOL book to get yourself familiar with how stuff works. Now, in the COBOL output that I showed you earlier, there's some line, there's the date tape of the COBOL compiler. And the COBOL compiler date tape is 1972. But there is not a lot of changes since then. Yeah, it's become modernized and there's object-oriented stuff and whatever, but it works. And if you want to learn the basics of COBOL, this will be more than enough to get you started. And you have your complete mainframe environment, so because you can learn COBOL on Linux. Linux, and you need a mainframe context to really understand how stuff works on a mainframe. So there are tools available. I know of a friend of mine who has publicized in open source. How do you say this? I forgot the name of his project. Well, I haven't, but you could use that. It's written in COBOL and get that to run on the mainframe. I would say so at the moment. Yes, it can even run ZOS. It's not legal, but it can. There are even on internet places where if you really are interested and you don't mind being You can download ZOS. The last release is 60 gigabytes, so it's a lot for operating system. But it's I would say its main purpose would be educational or interest or hobby. Okay, any more questions? Okay. It will probably return to you sooner than it will for the first time. So, okay. Anybody else with a question? Yep. Well, if you really want to, so you can use the startup script, and the startup script does the IPL for you, and the IPL stands for initial program load, and it's the same as what we call booting, IPL. So IPLing the system, and in the console you can change runtime parameters. You can, if you like, abort JES2 if it hangs or something, which it shouldn't, of course. And so at first I started with the TK3, not 4-, but 3 turnkey system. And then you have to do the manual IPL. And it's documented on the website, but you're just entering commands. And it's primitive. It's very primitive. This is much easier just to get you started. But nevertheless, you can you can do a lot on the console if you like. It has its own command structure. Where you can see all active subsystems, where you can end subsystems, where you can attach devices to the system, if you like. Okay. Anybody else? So. Well, then I'll put a slide on the website. So if you want to start experimenting yourself, you have some links to use, and it's really fun. It's I have my personal AS400 at home. It's similar to a mainframe but smaller. And if I tell that the mainframe guys are insulted and the AS400 guys are also insulted, but to me it's similar at the outside. It's a similar primitive screen, but it's computing fun, as simple as that. Okay, well, thanks for your attention and...